Hello, everybody. This will be a demixing video, taking the track that you can hear playing through to a program called Ultimate Vocal Remover, and we'll demix into, I think it's 6 stems, and then we'll take those stems, clean them up in spectral layers, and then take them on to DaVinci Resolve, just to do a quick Dolby Atmos spatialised mix or version. I'm not going to remix, it's simply a spatial version of the stereo track. That's really where the demixing can work. When you start remixing, then you're introducing a lot of the artifacts audibly. I'll come on to why it can work and why it can't later. But anyway, we'll get cracking. So we got Ultimate Vocal Remover, which is what we'll demix with. We'll process the stems that this tool, Ultimate Vocal Remover, manages to remove, and then we'll take those stems into DaVinci Resolve and create an Atmos mix. The track that you just heard, I've split into left and right channels. What determines whether you need to do that is purely if the recording's got some hard panning in it. If it's got some hard panning of instruments or especially vocals, which this particular track does, by processing it twice, you kind of get the best shot at demixing the vocals. I think in reality, certainly if you were doing this as a commercial release, hopefully you would get the vocal stems, and then the worst case would be only the instrumental, which does allow a lot more freedom. Obviously, if you can get the multi-track stems all individually, then you don't need to be concerning approaching a demixing method. You've got the audio there. Okay, we'll open up Ultimate Vocal Remover. This is a free program. Search it up on Google and you'll find it. Essentially, it combines a lot of various tools to demix audio with, or to separate. I think VR, the ensemble mode, they're primarily just focused on removing vocal. We're going to be using Demix, and the latest version of Demix is version 4. And these are considered for just this demonstration. It's going to be easier just to show a straight demix without going into, like, there's lots of settings to optimize the separation, but that's really another video in itself. But this Demix 6S means 6 stems. The normal Demix is 4 stems, so vocal, usually guitar, bass and drums. The 6 stems just adds piano basically, but it's diminishing returns using the 6 stem, but sometimes nice to kind of have, like, the other sort of stem that couldn't really be demixed to anything specifically it's still nice to have that as a separate stem, because it might just be kind of some droney sort of background sound, but once we come to spatialise that, it all kind of all makes sense. So what we'll do, I have run this once just to check that we get something usable, but essentially I'm flying blind doing this for the first time. So I've already got my output set. I normally just set it to a folder so I know where all this is going. It runs on the GPU if you've got NVIDIA, because I think underneath this is using one of the AI tools, and a lot of them are written in Python and optimized for CUDA. So ironically, even though it's audio, it's using the power of graphics processing to speed it up. I'm actually only on my laptop, so this isn't going to be fast, so I'll probably fast forward, save you experiencing a status bar. Invalid directory. We've got to go create one. I'll just call it stems. Okay, so we're just going to process the left channel into six stems. And then when that's complete, we'll move on to the right. It's actually not going too badly on this old laptop, so maybe I won't need to fast forward. When we take these stems into spectra layers, what that tool allows us to do is A, check that what we've got is comparable to the master that we've demixed from. It's quite important that you notice any either missing pieces of audio, which can sometimes happen, but also any editing that you do to the audio. Right, so that's the left channel complete. We'll just select the right channel, process that. Yeah, it's quite important that you edit non-destructively. So all that means is any edit you make to the audio, say you cut and paste something, that paste is always maintaining the integrity back to the master. And that becomes apparent when you're playing all the stems back concurrently. It's that concurrent playback that makes it still sound exactly like just the two-channel stereo master that you've demixed from. Without that, you applied some compression and EQ on just the drums, well, there'll be artifacts added or exaggerated or even removed. And even though it's a drum stem, some of that audio might well be belonging to something else, to another stem. It doesn't matter that it's not perfect, because, as I said, everything's playing back concurrently. And so all those artifacts are summing together to recreate what the stereo playback resembled. It'll become clear later. Right, so we've demixed those. As I said, there's a crap load of settings and additional models that you can add to the algorithms, but it's really not worth discussing that. Well, certainly not on this video. That's a lengthy old video if we did that. Right, so we'll close that down. So that's given us those six stems on each side, left and right. I think they come out as stereo. Yeah, they come out as stereo. Doesn't matter too much, but I'll probably convert those to mono. Right, we'll open up spectral layers. This is actually quite an old piece of software. Yeah, this is quite an old, I had to pause there because when this opens it pulls the mic off for some reason. I'm having to go through a virtual AGO just to combine the mic and all these programs, which is not optimal, but it's not too bad. Right, let's bring those stems in. Actually, what we'll do first, we need a reference so that we can visually and audibly check what we're doing. So we'll take the left and the right split. Right, so it's brought those in as two mono channels, and we'll just group those and we'll call that master. Chuck those in there. Give ourselves a bit more room here. Right, so we've got left and, I think that's left and right. Looks like it. Yeah. I usually pick orange just because it shows up the spectrograph nicely. Right, then we'll bring in our stems. Because bringing in these two master mono tracks are mono, it will probably prompt us to convert all of these to mono, which is fine, that's what I want. Yeah, so it's just going to take half of each side and sum it down to mono. It's a shame there's not a way to just do this for all. I'll do this 12 times. Okay, right, so, and then basically we'll create our stems group. Within that, we will give ourselves a left and a right group. Just means we will be able to solo our groups. I'll put that up into stems. That one up there. Right. Just take all these down, left into left. So we'll rename all these as we go, as we decipher what each stem is going to be. That's all we're left. Right. Right, so coming back to this concurrently playing all the stems back, if I solo the master group, I've now got the left and the right split master showing in the in the screen. And if I do the same on the stems and switch, I've just held control and click the solo. We can switch between visually what's happened, and you'll see that it's roughly everything is there. It's a slight change, but essentially we've got the same waveform. And if I play this and then do that solo while it's playing, I doubt you'll hear any difference. So you can hear there's very, very, very little difference. So that's kind of proof that the Demix has maintained the kind of the integrity, and we've got all the stems. And that's quite an important step, because you could easily burn through half a day tidying all these stems up and then realize that either the algorithm's not quite grabbed all the audio, or there's some distortion on one, or noise is kind of summing together in a strange way, and you've got some buzzy sounds, which is quite common. But essentially, even though I'd check that a little bit more, I can see we've got a slight difference in this area here. But I'm not going to worry about that for now. I don't think it's actually audibly going to be noticeable anyway. Yeah, it's visually a little different, but sonically it's not really going to matter. Right, pretty much do some tidying up now. So I generally start at the low frequencies at the top, and then work my way down. So pretty much the bass out of the Demux algorithm, the bass, the drums, the guitar, and the vocals, they will be how they've been labelled. If we just take all this off. Right, so this is our left channel bass. Okay, it's not great on its own, but it doesn't need to be. We're not going to be remixing, so we don't need this perfect. Those artifacts that you can hear are going to belong to, some of that will be from the guitars, the drums, even the vocal. So long as we can't audibly tell that there's another sound there, you can kind of view it a little bit like traditional recording, where you'd have bleed into the mics of all the instruments and the singers, and obviously when that's all summed together, you don't identify it as bleed. It's just part of the track, and the same will happen here. Right, so that's our bass. I'm pretty happy with that. So what I do, I just shorten all this. I tag it with L, just so that later on when we export all this, I know what was left and what was right. Right, onto the drums. Pretty much, I'm sure these will be relatively clean. Yep, so I'm happy with that. So, drums left. Switch to guitar. pretty sure this will be usable. Okay. So it's never going to sound particularly great on its own for this style of music. If you've got quite open, wide dynamic range kind of material with lots of air around the instruments, you can get some really good separation, especially if you spend the time in the algorithm side and here in spectral layers. Right, let's move on to the left channel vocal. Normally when you see isolated things like this, it's either going to be kind of breaths, it will be audio that should really be in one of these other stems, or it's kind of crossed over where it's half vocal, half instrument, but the frequencies are so similar that the algorithm has had to put them somewhere, and this is where it will be. I'm pretty sure this is, there's like a little screechy sound in the stereo that we heard, so I'm pretty sure that's what this is. Yeah. So immediately I'm gonna just create another stem group, another stem track now, and we'll move all this into there. You've got minimum and maximum amplitude. It's sometimes good to lower the minimum amplitude just so that you can see a little bit of the noise. This is so quiet, you can't hear it. But when I'm selecting, I quite like to at least select within any sort of audio if I can. This is a vertical selection tool, and it's got a 30-second fade on it. Sorry, 0.3-second fade. Probably about 15 is good for just simple cuts. You've got to remember that the fade is a certain amount of time as well, so select more than you think, but you can just play the selection. Okay, we don't need to be particularly accurate on this because it's just a sound on its own, so just check that you've captured it all. There's various shortcuts, but I'll use the menu just so that it visually shows what I'm doing. So I don't want this in the vocal layer, I want it in a new layer, so we'll cut to layer, Control Shift and X, and let's put it into there. I don't really know what that noise is, so I'll call it zipper. So we've got that. Cool. Pretty might as well rename this vocal left now, because that's definitely the vocal. Right, I think some of this will be breath. It's a strange breath, but I think that's what it is. Right, we've got another squelchy thing there. Can hear it, is like a weird echoey sound going into the vocal a bit. Don't think we're going to get that. I'm not too worried about getting it perfect. Yeah, I'm not going to take that little echo bit. I'm going to leave that with a vocal. Okay, so basically cut that. So Control Shift X. What is it to copy to lead there? Cut to layer below, Shift and X, sorry. Forgot what it was, right, Shift and X. So we've now got that.
The extent of its paradox only be equaled by, because it wanted to
that's the zipper sound, and then there's the intake of breath there. So just going to take need to just drop this down a little bit, 10.10. Shift and X, that's that. See what else we got.
It wanted inside.
Another zipper sound there. Okay, we've got a little bit of the voice with that. I think it's mainly these brighter areas here. If we just zoom in on that, keep the refinement. I generally keep the refinement low because it uses a lot less GPU then. But if we just refine that a little bit, you can see that this is basically where that sound mostly is. It's just the tail of a voice. I'm not going to go crazy on this, but if we just use a lasso, put a little bit of a fade on, and I think that's mostly going to be around kind of that. Right, so that's on the zipper. So unfortunately, you have to keep moving layers. If we do edit, cut special, cut to layer below, that'll put it back in the vocal. As I said, this is all non-destructive editing, so that audio has non-destructively moved from vocal to zipper, and now I've edited zipper and put some of it back into vocal. And this is the kind of iterative process of isolating the sounds and improving the quality of the stems, because you've got to remember, if we had a zipper stem as an object once it gets to Atmos, and we've panned that to the left in the mix, this vocal, or say we panned it to the right, this vocal, we're going to pan it to the right perhaps, or the left, that's got to follow where that zipper sound is. If it doesn't, it's just going to sound, or it could sound weird. For this, it wouldn't really matter because the listener's not going to know if it should be in left or right, or if it's changing. But it's always good to get as much control over the object as you can. So that's why I'm spending the time to isolate this zipper. So I think there's probably a couple more. Let's see what we've got. Looks like generally you get a feel for what sounds look like. Okay, that's actually just a breath. Just a breath. Nothing there. Oh, got both there. Okay, so we're going to have quite a tight selection. Probably come down even tighter. 0.05. Okay, I'm happy with that. We're going to do the same again. We're going to get, you can see the vocal harmony here coming through, and that's tailing off into this zipper sound. So we'll do a shift and X, take it down to zipper. So I think it's mainly these sections here. There is harmony selection, which you can use. What it does, it kind of automatically tries to select the harmony based on the kind of the root of where it thinks you are. So normally, if you start at the root note, and just keep selecting until you get something that roughly looks right. So that's that kind of third harmonic up. That's the majority of the sound there. So if we know that that third one works well. So if we make the master rank is 3, which is why that's worked. We could probably, so that master rank of 3 and it's selecting the 5 harmonies. If we increase that, I reckon there's going to be about 7 or 8. Yep, so let's select that. I think we can probably go up a little bit more. Let's go up to 4 pixels. See how long we can drag this out for. Okay, I don't think we need to go that far. I reckon about... if we go about there. Same thing again, move the layer back up. Shift X. Put that back in into the vocal. Probably took a little bit too much there. Let's just undo that. Go back to zipper. I think it's mostly just there. Shift X that down. Yeah, that's good. We can't hear her in it anymore. Okay, I'm happy with that. It's not perfect, but if we you can spend, as I said, hours and burn through a day easily doing this. We've got a little bit of a that echoey sound there, but so faint, I'm not going to worry about that.
Was in the limit, was it could not suffer the unknown thing at the same time of wanting to.
Okay, we got one there. Don't think that's one. All that. No.
Set up.
Okay, so it's starting in this patch here. So we need to select just up to there. Maybe start a little bit earlier. Okay, same again, Shift X. Take that down to zipper.
Set up in.
With that, I think that might be all of them.
The spectator through the glass, what a glorious view! Relish.
Yep, I think we're there. Okay, we've got a little bit of residual sound here. A little bit there. It's impossible to really tell where that belongs, so it could just be noise in the recording when they recorded the vocal. It doesn't really matter. Right, before we move on, I'm just going to save this project. Call it Margerine Rock. Spectralized project. Even if it crashes, it does remember the state, so it's all usable. Right, we got zipper done, I think. Right, we've now got, this is the last two are often just kind of, they belong to the track, but you can't really separate them out. Sometimes you can. Okay, so we've got some like effects. There's a bit of background, which is probably it's kind of relating to the guitar that. I think what I might do, for the sake of speed, we won't do. We could separate these, but I'm guessing, I bet we've got some of that in the vocal as well. Let's just take those off.
The extent of it.
No, not too bad. Where was it? I got another bit there.
Wanted.
Yeah, there's a little bit in the vocal. I think what we'll do, it's only there. Okay, so we've really just got three there. I think what we'll do, just for now, take a 15 second fade off. We'll just I think we'll put them into the zipper and we'll just call this zipper effects, I think, because that's really all they are. Right. So same again, have to move the layer above where you're dropping it down to. Shift, just change the colour of this so we can see it. Shift X, right. So we've now, that's kind of like a call and response, I guess. So we need to do the same for the rest. So we've taken that one out. We've got a little one here, I think. Or there. Shift and X that. And then got the same here. Take that out. That might belong to it as well. The rest of that is just background. So just for now, we'll just call that background left. We'll come back to that. We've got something that's labelled as piano, but there's no way that's piano. So we've got a kind of starting dong. Pretty much guitar. Little bit of that effects there, so we can take that, move that down, very slight, but so shift X that down, so it looks drastic because I've got this sensitivity the amplitude up so high. What am I just do there? Did I just change the opacity? That's better. Right. Where were we? Okay. there. Shift X that down. And then we've got, is it over here? Same again there. Shift X that out. Right, so that's all our effects done. So really, what we're left with is this indistinguishable background sounds. I'm gonna just merge these up, just call all that background, and really the only sound that it is relating to is the guitar. I don't think we're going to end up turning these sounds into objects. They're just not defined enough. So we'll just merge those into the guitars. So we've been left with bass, drums, guitar, vocal, and some effects, which when it comes to the objects, panning and automation, you could have a little bit of fun with that. So that's the left channel done. Right channel's pretty much going to be a similar process. I'll do less talking and just get through this. So we've got drums left. Shut the bass up there. Bass left. Guitar left. Oh, what am I doing? Right. Bass guitar. Let's do bass drums. Guitar, vocal, other. Right. Bass, I'm guessing that's going to be very similar to the left track. Yep. And drums. I think we have a strange panning thing going on with the drums. With the left and right. So it's kind of like doubled up. Some triangle stuff there. So I'm happy with that. Guitar. Some of that background that was in the left channel could well belong more over this side, but what's going to happen when we come to do the object is probably the guitar, because it's quite a stereo sounding guitar, that will be a stereo object. So these two layers will effectively end up as a stereo piece of audio. Got the vocals again. Not sure what that is. Could be part of the bass or the drums. Let's have a look. Yeah, I reckon that's, that can go up to, go down to the bass, that can. So just shift X. That's in the bass now. Let's happy with that. I don't think we've got any squelches or anything, or zipper sounds there. I think that's clean. Okay, there's a bit of a, not sure if that might be in with a guitar. Yeah, I reckon that's Just solo the guitar there. Yeah, it's got split. It kind of sounds human. A little bit human, so it's decided to take some of it into the vocal, but I'm going to move that into the guitar layer. So we've got a bit of vocal there. Shift X. That's now in there. You can see the line of that neural. Cool. I think that might be it. That's not vocal, whatever that is. Is that in the guitar? Yeah, so what we'll do, if we just take a slightly longer fade. Okay, I reckon we can go a bit longer. I'm just gradually moving the block as I press spacebar just to see all this or hear all this selection. Right, shift and X, track that down into guitar. Cool. Nice, right, so we're done there. See what we've got going on here, but I think we've got that start dongy thing. That's there. Have we got anything in this? Right, it's not in that layer. But was there? I thought. Where else have we got that dong sound? It's not in bass. It's not in drums. It's not in vocal. It's not in guitar. It's only in piano there. Is it in this one? No. But was that in? Okay, so it's in guitar left. And what we could do is separating that out, because we might be able to do something with that when it's in Atmos. Right, so if we control shift X, that'll put that into its own layer, and we'll just call that gong left. And we've got the same going on here. Control shift X. And that's gone right. Got to remember, when you're hearing these left and right channels, it's been distributed to stereo, so it's not how it's actually going to sound once we group these all back together in Atmos, because it will be in stereo in Atmos, whereas you're listening to this all mono. As am I, but there's no advantage to working in stereo. Let's just want to play both of those. Cool. That's that on the last layer now, which. Okay, it's similar to the left channel. It's all going to probably belong to guitar. need to go into relates to that guitar there. Right, I think all of that, you could just merge all of that up into guitar. Often when you just kind of A-B the waveforms, you can often see that, oh yeah, that's kind of related. I can see we've got this energy in this bit and this bit through here. So this track is almost silent. There's hardly anything in this. So I think keep this simple. Let's merge those two together. That's not going to be usable as an object, so let's just keep it with guitar. So guitar's become a bit of another kind of grouping, really, but it shouldn't matter because we did the same with guitar left. So right, we'll just do a quick visual inspection. So we've got all of our stems, and that's our master left and right. So we're still looking very similar, which is what you want. And if I just play back from the middle of the track somewhere. Okay, so we know that we've non-destructively tidied all that up. We're still A-B-ing exactly the same with the master. Visually, we can't see any difference. So we're in a good place to hear how that's going to sound once some of the stems are in their stereo kind of panning, and also see what control we've got to maybe spatialise a little bit more once we get to Atmos. So I'm going to stop the video. Just set up DaVinci Resolve so you don't see me doing that. And we'll continue with the Atmos mix. Okay, so we'll open up DaVinci Resolve. We've got essentially 12 stems that we've sorry, my audio cut out there just as DaVinci Resolve starts. So we've got 12 stems. We've demixed, cleaned them up. Now we're gonna take them into objects in order that we can spatialize them in Atmos. What I'll do, rather than typically, I'll take these into another audio editor and do a few more bits, but we'll just pull all of those into DaVinci Resolve. The good thing with DaVinci Resolve is you can manipulate. Actually, jumping ahead of myself here. we didn't do one step. We've got to go back to spatialised. It's only the most important step I've missed. Yeah, we need to export all of our stems. That's why they were stereo. So file, export audio of all layers. Call those clean stems. That's basically what we've just done. Select those. I don't need 32-bit, 24-bit will do. Cool. Right. Right, let's bring those in. Clean stems. That looks better. Right, so we should have all of these in mono, which is what we want. We can link these together within DaVinci Resolve later on. So what we'll do, pretty sure that bass will be our first track we'll deal with. And when you create a new timeline, you decide what that first track you want to be. So I think we'll probably go with stereo on the bass, because I don't remember it being particularly different left or right. We'll just leave the rest as default. Okay, go into Fairlight. In DaVinci Resolve, the Studio Edition has a built-in renderer. The reason I'm using this rather than the full Dolby Atmos renderer is it's easier to record the screen on this, and it's all in one place, and it's a lot simpler to see what's going on. But yeah, essentially you need to set up immersive audio for Dolby Atmos. That's pretty much all you have to do. Okay, so that's our first stereo track, so I know that's actually going to be bass, so I might as well just name that now. Right, and you can, in DaVinci Resolve, you can drag mono tracks into the first channel. The second channel, you can't. It either wants a new track or overwrite the existing. So what you have to do is convert to a linked group. Now we've got a stereo track that we can drag mono sounds in. So now essentially we've got an unlinked stereo track. This isn't going through Dolby Atmos, this is just plain stereo at the moment. Okay, so that's our bass, and this is the principle for everything else we're going to do now. So with drums, I'm going to keep as separate objects, actually, because I remember they're quite a bit different from each other. So I'll just call that drums L. Drums right. Not sure on the guitar whether we'll. We're not going to have a lot of panning freedom to use these as separate objects, so I think we'll just create a stereo track for those. Call those guitar. We need the MUN links. And left into left, right into right. I think other. This is where it was really just background sound, so again, we better keep those as stereo. We can change our mind later. But let's just call that other for now. Got the start gong, which doesn't really matter, but might as well keep it stereo. Start gong left, start gong right. We've got our vocals, they were definitely mono. So we can just have an object for each of those. So that'll be vocal left, vocal right. I think that's it. Oh, we've got zipper as well. Which is a mono. Cool. Just tidy this up a bit, close the media pull down, just a bit of colour on these. Brown for base. Go for beige for drums. Vocals I'll keep green. I don't know why, but vocals are green. Zipper. I'll go for pink. Cool. Alright. So we'll just play it back.
The beauty of this creature could only be.
That audio ducking is just my mic. So already it's starting to sound back to more of its stereo self, because we've obviously got some stereo tracks here. I'm just going to tidy these ends up. Oh. Just get all this the same length. That's it. Right. Right, yeah, if I just get the length on that. Right. As we're using the built-in renderer that comes with DaVinci, we've got to set up, basically got to set that up at the moment. Our main B chain is just straight stereo. So we need to create a Dolby Atmos master bus, basically. Just call that Atmos. And that immediately gives us access to the renderer. All of our monitoring modes, when you're connected to speakers, be a 7.1.4. Probably a good idea to put your headphones on now, because I'm going to switch this over to binaural mode. Binaural, it's the same mix, but it's not the speaker output. It's run through some binaural room kind of emulation and HRTF. I'll just show you where we set this up. It's familiar if you've done anything in the Dolby Atmos renderer. So we'll take the track direct, which is the straight post fader output of our stems, and literally you patch them to the Dolby Atmos renderer. So that should be everything. Patch that. So now, rather than each track just routing out of the output, stereo output, they're now outputting through the Dolby Atmos renderer. And then depending on what we select here, they'll either go to my speakers or to the binaural. What that relates to in terms of Atmos is each track has a binaural render mode. This is really a kind of a distance setting for how the room feels. So mid is assumed to be the walls are about, I think it's about 2.5 meters either side of you. So it's emulating you being in a room. It's kind of like a short reverb, like a binaural reverb almost. It works better with some sounds than other. But if I just isolate, let's just isolate the vocal. Just take that left vocal. I'll turn it off for now. Right, and we'll just hear this play back, and then I'll change the binaural mode. So this is a mono object in the 3D panner. So it's got one blue sphere representing that it's a mono signal, and then for stereo objects you still get the panning position, but each signal is represented by a left and a right sphere. So I'll just play this vocal, and then we'll switch this binaural mode, and you should hear some difference.
The beauty of this creature could only be equaled by the extent of its paradox, only be equaled by, because it wanted to.
Okay, so you can kind of hear that it's immediately sounding more like it's in a room.
Conflicting. It wanted the light, it wanted everything inside. Wanted to dominate, or at least to participate, but only in the comfort of its chair and its slippers.
So it's a bit of fun, but you can get some quite nice effects by choosing wisely what your render mode's going to be. By default, everything is mid. We'll leave it at that for now. We'll probably come back to this a little bit later. Right, let's get back to our mixing. Right, so we've got a stereo bass. I generally start without anything on the bass, almost definitely never the drums, guitar. If it's been recorded in a sort of close fashion, then sometimes near can work, but I try and match the ambience of the recording with kind of the binaural feel. Stuff like the zipper and the gongs won't really matter, but I would actually take a guess and we'll go on fire on those. I'm just going to mix this up a bit. Vocal, it's a really close vocal, so I'm going to keep those in there. That other background sound, I reckon we can get away with far. So we're trying to spatialise, and I want to make it obvious, especially once this is on YouTube, you'll miss half of the detail of this binaural. Guitar can stay on mid. Right. And what we'll do is just that gong drum. So I'm going to take the vocals out of quite so much. Actually, we need to reset this. So our left and right vocal, obviously this is just messing around, doesn't really matter where we put these, but we'll keep it within. So we'll go 50 left on the left vocal, we'll go 50 right on the right vocal. And the zipper sound, we might be able to do something a bit more extreme with that. Right, and obviously we're following the stereo kind of vibe, so we can't change anything too much. But what we can do is just bring every sound into the room a little bit. At the moment, you can see everything is panned hard left and right, and hard against the wall, i.e. left and right speaker. An easy kind of way to get a bit of feel is to increase the size. If we just solo the bass, you might be able to hear it spatialize a little bit as I increase the size. So that's a 3D size, so that's going in kind of all directions. And then you've got a 2D size, which maintains the kind of horizontal level, that's my understanding anyway. So 2D wouldn't expand into the heights, whereas I guess a 3D does, or that might be entirely wrong, but that's how I hear it. I think we'll go with 10 on everything for now. Consistency is quite important, because we've obviously got some artifacts, the separations are not perfect. It pays dividends to keep your changes relatively consistent, especially when it comes to panning and what's moving into other speakers at this stage, and then we'll get a bit more daring and see what works. This is just an easy way to kind of get a stereo plus kind of feel going. I'll probably do something a little bit more extreme with the vocal, because we've got a bit more control there. And then we'll play some things. 10 on there. That zipper sound I'm actually going to leave close. So I think that was, that could be quite a nice effect. Right, let's play back that, see how we're sounding. Think I can immediately hear some things that we can improve. I think we can bring the right vocal more centered. And kind of trying to open that up a little bit, because it's recorded quite a way away. And also I'll put a far binaural room on that. So if I just play that through, you'll see what I mean. We'll get up to the la la bits here. Okay, and I'm actually gonna bring that left in as well. In the spectator. messing around really. Be nice to do something with his zipper. Okay, that's pretty much the complete process. When I was putting these density plugins in, it's just adding a bit of punch, and I think it holds the sound together a bit better. But I hope that kind of gives a nice overview of the complete process. Obviously, the more you put into the AI demixing part, the higher the quality of the stems. Same again in the spectral layers, the more you do there, the more you get back to a point. You've got to decide what's worth trying to extract and what isn't. If you've got some stems to turn into objects from the multi-track, and then some you haven't, then obviously the quality and the freedom you'll have to pan things are going to be even greater, because you've got a clean piece of audio, so you can apply more effects, more EQ, more dynamics, because that isn't going to get applied to the artifacts that are there from the separation. But it's all good fun, and you can see it's relatively easy to get a quick spatial version from any stereo track, because each of these stems are playing back together, and we've edited non-destructively. As long as we don't take the panning too extreme, you wouldn't know that that's necessarily come from a stereo master only. If that's all you've got, you can't get multi-tracks, then this is one option, rather than just chucking everything through an upmix, plug in like Halo or Penteo. The slight 2D and 3D increase in size, that's kind of a little upmix on each track. If I switch to 7.1.4, close this down. So this is the main Dolby Atmos 12 channels there. When I play that, you'll see it's not just the first two left and right channels, but we've got all channels being fed. So that's a result of us A panning up, down, left and right, and also increasing the size of the object. Anyway, I hope that's useful. I think the next video I will go into much more depth on the AI demixing. We've just used a generic off-the-shelf solution to do a quick stem demix and rebuild, but you can go quite deeply into that on optimizing, and also using different algorithms for different types of music, working out what suits the end goal more than another algorithm. Until next time, have fun. Cheerio. Bye.